Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I see we have a returner to us. Welcome, Miss Judy, on this very rainy morning. I want to welcome you all this morning to Christ Church. I hope that you'll be blessed by this service. And I'm also welcoming those online who are joining us by Facebook. Good morning and welcome. Before I get started this morning, I am going to read a letter from our bishop, as well as the prayers that he has asked for us to pray. Would you please stand? Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, we commend to your care President Donald Trump and First Lady Melania. Comfort them in their suffering, lend skill to all who attend them, and bless the means used for their cure. Touch them with the healing presence of your Holy Spirit, and draw them to even greater faith in you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. O Father of mercies and God of all comfort, our only help in time of need, we humbly beseech thee to behold, visit, and relieve thy sick servants, President Donald Trump and First Lady Melania, for whom our prayers are desired. Look upon them with the eyes of thy mercy, comfort them with a sense of thy goodness, preserve them from the temptations of the enemy, and give them patience under their affliction. In thy good time, restore them to health, and enable them to lead the rest of their lives in thy fear and to thy glory, and grant that finally they may dwell with thee in the everlasting, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now follows his letter. This morning, the scripture verse which led the first part of morning prayer was, "Thus says the high and lofty one who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and holy place, and also with those who are contrite and humble in spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite." That is from Isaiah 57:15. We all live with divided hearts. We know the power of prayer, yet we are hesitant to pray. We know we are to pray for our leaders, yet we rarely remember to do so. We are preoccupied with many things, so we often fail to pray. Yet we are a nation in great need. Evidence of God's judgment is present in our lives. Fire, pestilence, violence, drought, earthquakes, and social unrest. If there was ever a time for people to pray for our president and our country, it is now. This is a time for people of faith to unite in prayer, especially as we approach the upcoming election. I would urge you to make the time to pray. If you have been remiss in praying for the president and our country, repent of this oversight and carve out a regular time to pray each day. Finally, our presiding bishop has also asked us to pray. He writes, "At this particular moment, I ask that all Episcopalians also pray for the President and First Lady and all in the White House or government who have been affected by this virus. Regardless of your politics, if you have said yes to Jesus, you bear an obligation given to you by God to pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Please make the time to pray." Thank you, Gregory O. Brewer, Bishop, Episcopal Diocese of Central Florida. Our opening hymn, "And Can It Be That I Should Gain?" Thank you. God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Desire or deserve. Pour upon us the abundance of your mercy. Forgive us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and given us those good things for which we are not worthy to ask, except through the merits and meditation of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Please be seated for our readings.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. Let me sing for my beloved my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its walls, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his pleasant plantings. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed, righteousness, but heard a cry. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 80. Let us read responsibly by half verse. We will begin and end with the refrain.
The vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel.
Restore us, O God of hosts.
Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved.
You have brought a vine out of Egypt.
You cast out the nations and planted it.
You prepared the ground for it.
It took root and filled the land.
The mountains were covered by its shadow.
And the torrent cedar trees by its boughs.
You stretched out its tendrils to the sea.
And its branches to the river.
Why have you broken down its wall?
So that all who pass by pluck off its grapes.
The wild boar of the forest has ravaged it.
And the beasts of the fields have grazed upon it.
Turn now, O God of hosts, look down from heaven. Behold and tend this vine.
Preserve what your right hand has planted. The vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. If anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born to Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ and righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on towards the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Would you please stand and let us sing our sequence hymn, God, the Uncreated One.
He is King forever. He is King forever. He is King forevermore.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized the slaves and beat one, killed another, and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, they will respect my son. But when the tenants saw their son, they said to themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance. So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, he will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at harvest time. Jesus said to them, have you ever read in the scriptures, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone? This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because they regarded him as a prophet. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Yeah, we sang it a number of times. Anyone seen the squirrels recently?
No.
No?
No.
Squirrels. Am I saying it right? Is that my Bajan accent coming out? A squirrel.
Squirrel.
Yes. Okay. Anyone seen them recently?
Yes.
I think I saw a couple of them. So a guy was crossing the street to visit his neighbor. And as he started to cross the street, a car was bearing down on him. So he stopped and backed up to the curb. The car stopped, so he started to cross. And the car started to move toward him. He changed direction and went back to the curb, and the car moved toward him. Then he moved to run across the street, and the car swerved in that direction. He moved left, and the car moved left. He moved right, and the car moved right. Finally, he just stopped in the middle of the road. The car screeched to a stop right in front of him. He walked around to the driver's window, and the window rolled down. The man was surprised to see that it was a squirrel behind the driver's wheel. The squirrel said, "I just wanted you to know how it feels." Yes, it is amazing how they dash across the street. And I'm the one that will screech the brakes because I don't want to touch them. Anyhow, Jesus is still answering the question the chief priests and the elders asked him last week. Do you remember what that question was? This was only last week, Patty, not a year ago. What was the question that was the chief priests and the elders asked Jesus last week?
By whose authority do you do these things?
Thank you, Rosemary. By what authority are you doing these things? So to further answer the question, Jesus tells them the parable of the wicked tenants. And as I told you last week, this is the second parable, and we have another parable coming up next week. Or there is another parable after this. The Old Testament reading and today's gospel carry the story of an exasperated landowner. In Isaiah, the landowner declares, "What more is there to do for my vineyard that I have not already done before?" What does that sound like? An exasperated parent. A teacher. Customer service rep. What more can I do? A priest. What more can I do? When you've given it all, your all, and you're just not getting the results that you want, how many times can you go tell your child to go brush their hair, brush their teeth, you know? How many times? We keep repeating it over and over and over and over when they were little. We find this sentiment in this week's gospel as well. Jesus appears to be almost at his wit's end. He appears to have moved beyond trying and is ready to throw in the towel. He cried, "Therefore I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom." We can hear the anger, the frustration, and really some defeat. We can also hear of a vineyard which the hearers of the parable would have been familiar with, because they know vineyards, and they would have been told the Isaiah story so many times. The gospel tells of a landowner whose care for his vineyard is evident. After planting a vineyard, a fence is built around it, and a watchtower is placed as a lookout. Care, attention, and protection are lovingly provided. In the Isaiah passage, the landowner goes a further step to say that the land used for planting was fertile. The landowner, my beloved, carefully removes the stones and only uses choice vines for planting. This landowner also has a watchtower erected in the midst of the land, and a wine vat is built. The landowner is ready to see the rewards from his care of the land. In the gospel, the landowner rented his land out to tenants with the intention of earning an income from their produce. This was a common practice for a landowner with quantities of land to rent out a tenant. The owner would naturally expect a revenue from the monies earned through the harvesting of the fruits. This was a practice I've seen many times. While my family did not own large acreage of land, my father would rent out small parcels to individual people to grow crops to feed their families. In return, he would receive a small income for the rental. As children, my sister and I spent many Saturday evenings running up and down that dirt, rich, deep, brown dirt, laughing and throwing mud all over us. Trust me, my father, and definitely not my mother, were pleased, but we were having a good old time. In his wildest dreams, I do not for 1 minute think my father thought he would never be paid that rental. This, however, was the fate of the absent landowner. So what we have in this writing of the story is what we call an allegory. Jesus is using it to show how he views the manner in which the religious leaders conduct their lives. An allegory asks that we look for the hidden meanings behind the literal meaning of words. God is the landowner who entrusted his land, Israel, the tenants. The religious leaders are the tenants who kill. Collecting his fruits are the slaves, the servants, the prophets and priests who are faithful, and the Son is Jesus. We are all stunned by the depravity of the tenants. Each time the landowner sends the slaves, he's hoping for a good outcome. He's hoping the tenants would listen to them. The slaves do not get that opportunity. Their lives are taken from them before they can collect his produce. He feels confident as he makes the last-ditch effort and sends his son. His son is not a slave. His son is someone the tenants would look up to. But all the tenants saw was a threat to their way of being. They did not respect the son any more than they did the slaves. He was also killed. For after all, he was a threat to their livelihood. The landowner is now without his slaves and his son. He trusted the tenants to do good by him, and they rejected the good he tried to do, and they rejected his son, just as the builders rejected the cornerstone. But Jesus will one day rise as the cornerstone that allows the kingdom to stand upright. And now, what is the landowner to do? Jesus asked the religious leaders, and they do not hesitate with their answer. I will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the harvest time. Knowingly or unknowingly, the religious leaders are describing their own fate. Think of what Jesus is really trying to tell the leaders. God has been trying for centuries and generations to send prophets and priests to warn Israel about their behavior. And with each generation, prophets are ignored and at worst, killed. The people he trusted to teach, the leaders, ignored what was right in front of them, just as the religious leaders of Jesus' time are doing before their eyes, his eyes. The religious leaders are quick to condemn the actions of the other's people, but really slow to see the error of their own ways. In the Isaiah reading, the landowner is truly disappointed that after all the care his land received, the crops only produce wild grapes. He is angry and threatens to take the hedge down and leave it for the animals and birds to attack and eat it. He will no longer prune or hoe it. We can all agree, the landowner God gave the tenants the right to the land, just as he did back in Genesis. When we read Genesis 1 in the creation story, he told us, let us make mankind in our image according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the earth. We cannot say the land did not produce, and hence the tenants had nothing to give the landowner. The land did produce, but the tenants' relationship to the land was all wrong. They were to be stewards, working the land to produce, a land that was so willingly and lovingly given to them. Yet they saw an opportunity to exploit and not to nurture and cultivate. At the right moment, the landowner God will take the land from the religious leaders and give it to someone who can produce the fruits that God wants. This would have been very disturbing to the hearers. Yet Jesus finds it necessary to make the threat, to take the land away, to wake up not only his followers, but the religious leaders who just were not getting it. We are the tenants today. God has entrusted his vineyard to us. This vineyard made up of people and land. Can we say that we have done what God has asked of us? Have we lived up to God's expectations? And we only have just enough time in which to accomplish his goals. Are we producing the fruits God is expecting us to produce? What is meant by fruit in the gospel? The Greek word is karpos, and it means that which originates or comes from something, an effect, a result, work, an act, or a deed. This is perhaps what Jesus was going after, at least I know that's what he was going after. He wanted to see something produced. He wanted to see an effect of what his work, his teachings, was having on the people. But more so, he wanted it on the religious leaders, and they were ignoring it. So what fruit are we hoping to produce? Developing our spiritual lives? Being involved in ministry? Showing the light of Christ in our homes, on our jobs, at our schools, at our community activities? During the fall months, most Episcopal churches conduct a stewardship campaign. Beginning today, Patty Cho will be introducing you to this year's stewardship campaign. And you may ask, what is stewardship? And I brought this to you a couple of years ago. Stewardship is everything we do after I say, I believe. So what is everything? We may say stewardship is giving of our talent, of our time, and money. However, it is even more than that. It is, how do we carry out the vision and the mission of Christ Church? And I think another question I would add is why? Why do we do that? Why do we do what we do? What is the church here for? Over the next 6 weeks, we will be looking at ways in which we can do so. You may say, but I already give up my talent, time, and money. Or you may say, I do not know what I can do. Or I have very little money. Remember, Jesus commended the widow who gave what she could. We are all busy. If I ask you right now, you would say you're all busy. Doing God's work, however, requires that we be available. Having good intentions are great. Yeah, let's do this. But somebody else is to do it, not me. So we all have good intentions, but putting it into practice is essential for living out God's plan for his kingdom. So what do we need to weed out of our gardens in order to free up our time? What wild grapes do we need to throw out? Perhaps stop watching the TV. With the weeds gone, fruit can grow in our bear fruit. This fruit allows us to be at one with Jesus. There's nothing between Jesus and us. We flow into him and he flows into us. Look at John 15:4-5. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as a branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. In all that Jesus has asked us to do, he does not leave us to fend for ourselves. He provides everything that we are going to need to do stewardship, to go on living. He goes wherever we go, and like the squirrel with the car, we cannot get away from him. As we go about our daily lives, it is easy to forget that the Spirit is with us. Christ Church, even in this unusual time, you have kept the church going. But as Jesus demanded more from us, we ought to demand more of ourselves. The bar is raised higher each year. Just as you make plans and set goals to be achieved in your personal life, so it is with the church as well. What are the goals and plans you would like to see achieved here at Christ Church? What is Jesus calling us towards? Perhaps that we are no longer an aided parish. The day that that happens, I'm going to go up there and ring that bell. You have no idea. Perhaps that we are no longer an aided parish. Today we move forward, as Paul tells us, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead. I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. We press on to what God wants for us, for our lives, and for this church. Let us pray for our church that it will produce the fruit God is asking of it. Let us pray. Cultivate your church, we pray, enriching it always with new shoots, so that grafted onto Christ, the true vine, the community of your people may bear fruit in abundance and produce a rich harvest for eternal life. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Would you please stand and let us renew our faith by the saying of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in the one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through whom all things were made. For us and for our salvation,
He came down from heaven, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary,
and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified.
He has spoken through the prophets.
We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic Church.
We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins.
We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please kneel as you are able for prayers of the people.
Yeah. I think it's these things.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying,
Lord, have mercy.
For the Holy Church of God, especially directors, vestries, and members of Christ Church Longwood, Church of the Resurrection Longwood, the Anglican Church of Tanzania, and other churches of Longwood, that they may be filled with the truth and love, and be found without fault at the day of your coming. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord,
have mercy.
O Michael Curry, our presiding bishop, Justin Welby, Archbishop of Canterbury, Gregor Brewer, our own bishop, Dr. Mambo Madolwa, Archbishop of Tanzania, for all bishops and other ministers, and for all the holy people of God, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease and that all may be one as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the mission of the Church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who do not yet believe, and those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the light of the gospel, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and people. For the well-being and protection of those serving in our country's armed forces, that they may serve with justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in the positions of public trust in this nation and the world, especially Donald, our president, Ron, our governor, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who live and work in this community, especially the mayor, commissioners, the first responders, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord,
have mercy.
For our blessing upon all human labor, and for the right use of the riches of creation, that the world may be freed from poverty, famine, and disaster, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, for persecuted Christians everywhere, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this congregation, for those who are present, and for those who are absent, that they may be delivered from the hardness of heart, and show forth your glory in all that we do, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being free from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We especially pray now for the members of our church, Barbara Campanero, Virginia Warner, Ed and Sandy Bonds, and Ed is back at home. Sandy Erickson is in the hospital but recovering. Beth Ann Yus, Rose Garcia, Mary Jo McDonald, Sandy Giles is in hospital but recovering. Marjorie Mays, Narissa Bears, Janet Marzi Hazen, Sandy Burkhart. We also pray for family and friends of Christ Church, Barbara Hartman, Pamela Vaughn, Dolores Grantham, Helene Markovitz is up in hospital and at home, Lorraine Anthony, Arthur Dash, Walter Redmond is also back at home, and we thank you, God. Redmond, Agnes Raffington. And for those who you will name out aloud or in the silence of your hearts.
President and Mrs. Trump. Joyce Durkee, Doug.
As we prayed earlier this morning, we remember President Donald Trump and his wife Melania and all those who have been affected by the COVID-19. Especially pray for those at home or in the hospitals. We pray for the doctors and nurses for renewed strength. We pray for those behind the scenes. We also pray for the pharmaceutical companies and researchers who are researching vaccines and medication to eradicate this virus. For those outside not suffering with the COVID-19, we also remember Ken and Cassie Beckles, Novella Penick, Audrey and Upton Porton, Lorazzo, Roger Verdi. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the communion of your church.
Henry.
We remember those who have died in the recent fires and natural disasters, and those who have died from the COVID-19, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Rejoicing in the fellowship of all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God. To you, O Lord our God. For yours is the majesty, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. Let us now confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent.
For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ,
have mercy on us
and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Please be seated. Do we have anyone celebrating a birthday? Well, I want to wish everyone up there on the web a very happy and blessed birthday. I hope that this week coming would be a wonderful one for you. Let's have the birthday song break.
To Jesus be true, bless and keep you your whole life through.
I know of one anniversary. This is Michael and Donna Pascarella. I believe they're celebrating their 39th wedding anniversary.
Wow.
So I want to wish them all the best. Continue to keep God in the midst of your marriage. They are a praying couple, and so I thank God for them and for them being here with us. Continue to keep them in prayer. Let's see, I think that's all I have. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
I see them bloom for me and you. I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white. On a brightest day, a dark, sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so beautiful in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by.
I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They really say, I love you. I see babies grow. I watch them grow.
Food for Longwood, we're getting quite a bit in, so let's keep that going. And this afternoon, in the midst of all the raindrops, I'm going to be blessing those little pets. Oh, sorry, your little pets. So please bring them out. We're starting at 4 o'clock. It's a very short service, and I have water, and I hope someone brings treats. I have plenty of water and nice, clean, fresh bowls for your little ones. So please bring them out as we recognize and celebrate the feast of St. Francis of Assisi. Julie, welcome home. Since Julie left us, she's had, can I say it out loud? She's had a knee replacement. She's celebrated a big birthday. I won't call the number. And she's doing well. So welcome back. It's good to see you in the house of the Lord.
Thank you.
I know, she's still working behind for Christ Church, you know. You know she can't keep quiet.
No. I've been painting for the Fall Festival.
Good, good, good. Yes, Fall Festival, November 21st and 22nd. I should have a little bit more information this week about that. Thank you for mentioning. We have a team of people who are going to be meeting this Wednesday at 6 o'clock to more bring things a little bit tighter together, know that you'll have some more information hopefully starting this week. Yes, Patty?
I have a question about the Fall Festival.
Yes.
Is the lady that
is in charge of the Mount Dora Festival, the same is...
It's the same organization.
Because they canceled the Mount Dora one.
They did? Well, this
one. And I'm just wondering if she's going to do the same to us, and the City Fathers, as I call them, don't know that.
I don't know. So, I don't know.
I hope they don't.
As far as we know, that it is still continuing.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I don't want to keep us much longer because I know that we have some speakers. So, Ms. Patty, would you please come forward?
Okay, because I need my glasses. I always forget glasses. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
As Mother Michelle kind of touched on it in her sermon about all the things that Christ Church does, and that Christ Church has survived the, I'm not quite sure of the word I'm looking for, the test of time, maybe?
Yes.
We've gone through lots and lots of changes over the years.
Yes.
And Christ Church has always survived.
Mm-hmm.
We need to, my focus is what I'm looking at is to think outside the box. What more can we do even though we're doing so much now? Mm-hmm. So in the next couple of weeks, I've already set up some speakers that are going to testify as to their feelings of Christ Church, what keeps bringing them back, why they keep coming back, and how we can continue sharing, how we can continue giving of ourselves, which we give so much now for such a small church, we give so much.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of just a little brief synopsis of what I'm thinking in my mind, and I'm going to be calling on people to help me with maybe being a committee to look to see what we can do outside. We already do the Sharing Center. We already do the Longwood Elementary School.
Mm-hmm.
No kids, I don't think, of schools. So. It's just things in the back of my mind that I've been thinking of. So if I do call on you, whether it be in church or by phone, just take a few minutes to pray on it, to listen to me, to think of sharing from your heart from what we can give and what we can continue giving. So at this time, I want to call Tamara to come up and do her first reading. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Patty.
You're welcome.
All right, so you all know that I have a tendency to get a little weepy, so I'm not going to get through this without any other interference, but I'll start with saying good morning, my Christ Church family, and that is what you are, my family. Although my time here is relatively short in comparison to many. In comparison to many of you, I have never felt more welcomed, loved, and at home. Almost immediately here at Christ Church. Christ Church has become a necessary and integral part of my life, and I believe made me a better, more thoughtful, and compassionate person. Mother Michelle and this church have a way of centering me, keeping me from losing my way through this life of ours, by always instilling love, hope, faith, and forgiveness. And so I thank you, Mother Michelle, and my Christ Church family, and I look forward to 2021.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you very much,
thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Yes, this is a very special group of people. Actually, I don't know if many of you realize, but I just celebrated probably about 2 weeks ago my third anniversary here at Christ Church.
Wow.
Yes. So you have been welcoming to me as well. And everyone says, oh, but you've got so much done. And I say, I can't do it without you. You could easily have said no, but you said yes. And so with God's help, we continue through building his vineyard and his kingdom. Amen.
Amen. But we're blessed to have you as well.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
And Michael.
That's the key thing to write.
Yes. Not an afterthought.
Elaine, anything? Are we good? All right. Ascribe to the Lord, honor due his name, bring offerings and pledges, and come into his courts with praise. Would you please stand and let us sing this hymn, Fight the Good Fight. This was an old tried and true. So I hope you guys know it. Please stand. Continue now with the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For by water and the Holy Spirit, you have made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth your glory in all the world. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who will forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Heaven and earth, full of
made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And we offer a sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be made acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we're bold to sing.
Keep the peace. Hallelujah. Thank you.
remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Amen. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. 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 The body of Christ. The bread of heaven. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The blessing of God, my Son, and Holy Spirit. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. For those who are unable to receive communion at this time, there is the act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you are already there, and I unite myself holy to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Our post-communion prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God,
Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ.
And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you, now and always. Amen. Would you please stand and let us sing our final hymn, Every Time I Feel the Spirit. You should know that one. He provides. So every time this week something upsets you, remember, God provides. He is in us and we are in Him. Amen?
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
That must be